Hello everyone, and welcome to this Moodle Academy webinar on creating quality quiz questions. I'm Mary Cooch, Education Manager, and I'm going to be going through the presentation with you. And I have alongside me Education Advisor Anna Krasser, if you'd like to say hello, Anna.
Hello everyone, nice to see you. A lot of people are still coming into the session today, so I'll keep an eye on that. And of course, your messages in the chat.
That's great. Thank you. Okay, so I hope you're going to enjoy this webinar today. There is a course attached to it as well. And we'd love you after the webinar to go through the course and get a badge if you want to, a badge of completion. I'm going to start by giving you an overview of what this webinar is about and also what it's not about. In other words, what we're going to cover and what we're not going to cover. So in other words, we are not going to look at the technical aspect of how to set up a quiz in Moodle. We are assuming you either know how to set up a quiz in Moodle, or if you don't know, we do have courses and videos showing you how to do it. So it's not that kind of a webinar. This is more on the pedagogical side, the teaching side of how to phrase your quiz questions so that they are both challenging, but clear and unambiguous. Nor are we going to look at how you can give feedback for each of the responses in quiz questions. This is really, really important, but in fact, we felt it's so essential that you give good feedback that it warrants a whole course or webinar in itself, and we didn't want to dismiss it by just trying to slot it into the 1 hour that we have for this. So you never know, we might have a webinar on feedback itself at some later point, but this is not for today. So what we are going to look at is, first of all, we'll explore some of the more popular question types that you can use in quizzes. And we're going to ask for your opinions of them. And then we're going to focus on what I quite like to call the question traps. In other words, what to avoid when you're creating questions. Our main focus, I have to say, will be on multiple choice questions. They are the most popular and the most versatile. And then having looked at some question traps, then we're going to look at some what I call question tips. In other words, as you're developing your quiz questions, what to think about to ensure that they are what we like to call quality quiz questions. So I hope that's okay. And we're going to start by looking at some popular question types. Now, the advantage of using the Moodle platform is that we have many different question types. And if you're creating your quiz and you click to add a question, you'll see, as in this screenshot here, the question chooser with a range of question types. And Moodle offers quite a few as standard, but there are also, if your admin allows, there are also what we call contributed question types, extra ones that you can add. What you may not know is that actually your administrator can order the question types in that list. They can put them in a specific order, for example, in order of popularity. So in this list here, we've got multiple choice is at the top as the most popular question type. And also, if desired, your admin can hide questions that no one ever uses or they don't want to use, just to simplify the question chooser. What we have here as our top four, I think are generally accepted to be the, you know, the most popular question types: multiple choice, matching, short answer, and true false. So I thought we would begin by just exploring these a little bit and looking at their pros and cons and asking what you think of them. So shall we do them in reverse order of popularity? So let's take a look at true or false first of all. And I have to confess that I just don't use true or false question types at all. Because primarily because the quizzes that I do, people can take them more than once, usually at least three times. And so it's pointless, because if you get a true or false question wrong the first time, then you're definitely going to get it right the next time. However, I did ask in the discussion forum in the course attached to this webinar of what people thought, and people were saying they like to use it as a very, very quick quiz, do it once only, quick knowledge check, perhaps with a time limit. So that's interesting. I'd like to hear shortly your opinions on those, along with short answer. Short answer question type I do use, I do like it, specifically because unlike the other questions, for example, multiple choice or matching, where the student sees the possible responses because you have provided them, with the short answer question type, they've actually got to think. They've actually got to use their brain and generate a response and type it in. That's good. However, it does mean that as the question creator, you have to think very, very carefully all possible answers. Do you include spelling mistakes, for example? Well, obviously not if it's a spelling test. Is it important to have lowercase, uppercase, capital letters, punctuation? Is one word okay? Would you accept more than one word? All of these things you need to think about. Otherwise, and again, I speak from experience, you'll have students complaining their answer was correct, but it wasn't marked as correct. There is an asterisk known as a wild card that can help you. But again, if you're going to use short answer, I think you really need to think it through. Going up our hit parade or chart of popular question types, we come to the matching question type. And as I was reading around this subject, I learned that as well as being easier for teachers to create, because you're basically having a statement which you split into two to get your two halves, unlike a multiple choice where you have to think of some possible answers which are incorrect, as well as being easier for teachers to make, it apparently is also easier for students to answer. They like matching questions. But again, that doesn't mean you can do it quickly without thinking. You need to ensure if you have several statements to match that it's not obvious which matches which, and also that it's not ambiguous. Perhaps there are two possible answers and yet you will only accept one of them. So once more, you really need to read it through, ask someone to check it for you. So we are coming to the officially most popular question type, multiple choice. And I have to say, just because something is popular doesn't mean you have to dismiss it or you have to use alternatives. Maybe it's popular because it's very, very good. It is certainly versatile as a multiple choice question type because you can use it for summative final examinations as in many places, but you can also use it for formative knowledge checks, continuous assessment as you go along. And of course, in Moodle's multiple choice question type at the moment, you can have one single answer. That's probably what we're looking at today. Or you can have multiple answers and a variation of grades. But the problem is, because multiple choice question types are the ones people think of first of all, and because it's so easy, they don't give enough thought to the careful creation of the question type, the questions. And it might be, and again, I speak from experience, it might be that because you didn't think enough, your question is too obvious, or your question is ambiguous and students don't know what the answer is. So that's what we're going to look at today. Question traps and then some question tips with a focus on multiple choice. But while we're still talking in general about question types, I would just like to pause myself for a little while and pass it over to you and ask you if you'd like to type in the chat, and I'm going to ask Anna to give me some comments there. Do you have a preferred question type? Are there certain question types you avoid? Are there quiz question types here that are not standard, but that you'd like to share because you think they're really worthwhile? Anna.
sorry, I was muted. What I want to say, actually, a comment. As you said, I'm not using a lot the short answer questions like you, and especially when I'm working with Greek. Greek have a difficulty in writing, and also there are accents, and it just makes so complicated things. You have to be very, very precise on what you describe and what you want. So yes, that's the question that I'm usually avoiding. And let me check. We had a question from Fairuz, who says that, is there a limit of the number of correct answers in short answer type?
I don't think so. No, I mean, if you think you're going to have a lot of variations, you can use that wild card, can't you? That could cover several possibilities.
Exactly. It depends how you will build it. I mean, if you offer a specific options, then the correct answer will be among the specific options. But if you provide the wildcard, then yeah, things are generic. We have a lot of comments. Lorraine says that I do like multiple choice, especially when you can allow more than one right answers. That's interesting.
Yeah.
Kim says that it depends on the purpose, and that I will agree with that. John says I use short answers a lot to test a different level of knowledge. Wildcard is useful, and students don't know if or where it is or where it will be used. Now that's sneaky, clever. Just says that I like to use true and false in a question page just to emphasize the fact. Multiple question types are difficult, one incorrect, one correct or nearly correct, and one nearly incorrect. Rupa says drag and drop into text is my favorite. Chris, our vocational departments like the drag and drop onto image questions technique to label diagrams. Steven, I like multiple choice as like multiple questions. Yes. Luca, I like multiple true, false, and K prime, but they are both not in standard. They are plugins. Yolanda says calculated question is a good type of questions for mathematical questions. Dave, formula math Q type. Kathy, gap fill, very versatile and can be used for asking questions in different ways that MVQS can do. Sonia, I like the Open University pattern much to enable long text entry questions with a model answer. Yeah. I like that too. Usually unscored, but sometimes with scored keywords. Filippo, it depends what I want to test. I like to use close for having questions in context, I guess. Richard, I've used simple calculation questions in multiple choice questions for topics in economics, like price elasticity. Mambatho says, I like multiple choice question. I hope I said correctly the name. Kat says, also votes for the drag and drop onto emails and can be very useful, but not accessible.
True.
Yes, that's a problem. And Alex says that I use multiple questions the most, but I often find it difficult to come up with alternatives besides the correct answer and not obvious wrong answers.
Yeah.
I would like to use the calculated questions more, but I think they are difficult to make.
Well, I struggle with calculated and calculated multi-choice and simple, but that's because it's not my area of expertise, really, I think. What you were saying about struggling with possible answers is something we will look at during this webinar. I'm going to move on because I think I'd like to now consider these question traps, what to avoid. And I was trying to think of the best way to do this. And I thought, well, why don't we have a quiz, a fun quiz, which is actually a really badly designed quiz or with some really badly designed question types. And I was trying to think of a topic that you wouldn't be familiar with, or most of you wouldn't be familiar with, because the idea I want to show is that even if you don't know the topic, the quiz is so bad that some questions you can get right anyway, and some questions nobody could get right, even if they are experts on the topic. Hence, I want to demonstrate question traps by using a very bad quiz. And one of you might smile here. I tried to think of something which I thought very few of you would know to use as our quiz. And I thought, let's use the Black Country. So the Black Country, I'm in the UK now, I'm in the north of England, but I was born here. It's an area in Britain, in the West Midlands. So that's the center of England, around Birmingham. And 200 years ago, it was a part of the Industrial Revolution, the early days. And you can see from this graphic here, chimneys, mines, mills, and so on, factories. And it was called the Black Country because of the black soot of the Industrial Revolution. It's now much cleaner, much more attractive, but it has its own distinct dialect. They speak English, but with many different words and grammar. And I grew up with the dialect because my father spoke it all the time. I had to translate for my family when I had a family because they couldn't understand him. My mother always used to say that my mother did not let me speak Black Country because she said, ladies do not speak Black Country, and I had to learn standard English. But our quiz is going to be on the Black Country dialect. And I'd like you, please, as we go along, there are seven questions. Keep your score just out of interest. And for each question, I want you, please, to type the letter A, B, C, D that you think is correct into the chat. And then I'll ask Anna just to tell me which answer is the most popular. OK, we'll try to move through quickly. But here we go. Question one, Black Country dialect. Black Country, the Black Country term for a road is an straight, osroad, way, or road. So please type your answers now. A, B, C, or D. The Black Country for a road is an. And as soon as people start typing, Anna, just let me know. Yeah. And straight.
Yeah, I think that most of them are A's, if I can count them correctly.
Yep, most of them are A's. The Black Country for a road is an straight, an os road, an way, or an road. Okay, so most of them are A's.
Yes.
That's really interesting. I asked my husband, that he's not from the Black Country, I had to translate. He said A too. This is very interesting because if you read the question carefully, and this is an English language question, this would be different in other languages. I speak other languages, so I know. But if you read the question carefully, it can only be B. There is only one right answer, because in the English language, if a word begins with a vowel, A-E-I-O-U, you have to say an, not a. So you cannot say an straight, you cannot say an way, you can only say an os road, because o is a vowel, okay? So the answer to question one is B. Just a little bit of extra information for you. Os is Black Country for a horse. So you can see how old the dialect is, because it actually means the road where horses used to go, the horse road, hundreds of years ago. There you go, little bit of extra information. So let's try question two. The Black Country word for it isn't is it ain't, tai, which is actually a shortened form of it ain't, it's not, or it war. Okay, please type your answers A, B, C, or D, the word for it isn't.
Okay, I think this time we'll go for more B's.
D, did you say?
B.
Ah, sorry, B. Okay, so the Black Country word, or it isn't, is B. You are correct if you said B. Two reasons. First of all, the question asks for a word, and Thai in B is the only one that is one word. The others are two words. And often you'll find, as a teacher, you are so keen, so enthusiastic to explain the correct answer that you sometimes give more information for the correct answer. So the lengths of your responses are different. So I really wanted you to know that Thai is actually the shortened form of it ain't, which means it isn't. And that is a kind of a clue as to B being the correct answer. A and C, I just made them up. D, for your information only, it wore is actually Black Country for it wasn't, but that's not relevant to this. Okay, keep your score, 2 out of 7, coming up with question 3. What is the Black Country term for a horse? Is it A, an os, B, a wuss, C, a caval, or D, a lorchet? So please type your answers here.
I think that everybody's paying attention.
And the answer is?
A.
Yes. Now, this is actually really important that I hope you knew it was A, because I actually told you in the feedback of question 1, the os road. And believe it or not, accidentally including the answer to a question in an earlier or a later question in a quiz happens quite often, even in official state exams. I used to teach languages at GCSE, that's the UK 16-year-old exam, and I noticed it on occasion in the reading questions of those exams. I took a B2 level Russian state language exam in March. There was a question I didn't know, but a few minutes later, I found the answer in another question. So I just went back quickly and added my answer there. So even in the highest, most officially checked exams, this can happen. Be careful not to give away questions in other, not to give away answers in other questions. Right, I made up the other three, by the way. Question number 4. In modern times, who speaks Black Country? Old people always speak it. Usually older people, nobody ever speaks it anymore, ever. Or Joe Biden, lol. Okay. Might need to think, but please type what you believe could be the answer. Old people always, usually older people, nobody ever, it's died out. Or Joe Biden?
Well, everybody's is mostly at B.
B, okay. Now, this is an interesting one for a couple of reasons. Again, you are correct if you put B, usually old people. The thing is, life and quiz questions are rarely absolute. So if you put always, never, nobody, it's probably not going to be the right answer. And you see, even then I said probably, because things are not absolute. So if you see something that is so definite and so black and white, it's probably not the right answer. The other thing I want to point out here is D, Joe Biden, lol. I used to do this a lot because I used to make quizzes for younger students because I thought, oh, it makes it more fun. You know, I could put in one of them or one of the teachers. But the thing is, it basically removes one of the options because he's obviously not Joe Biden. So the student doing the question only has to choose from 3 options here and not 4. So although you might think it might lighten the atmosphere, it actually means that one possible answer is removed and it makes it easier to guess. Okay, question number 5. All of these are one answer only, by the way. I should have put it in all of them, but I put it here. Okay, so where is the Black Country dialect spoken? One answer only, please. A, in the West Midlands area of Britain, B, in the centre of England around Birmingham, C, in the north of the UK, or D, only ever in Birmingham? Please type your answer. A or B or C or D.
We are battling between A's and B's, I think.
Right. Okay. Now that's interesting because they're both right. And this is a serious problem here. So A and B are the same. And this is a good example of where the teacher didn't reread or ask someone to proofread the question. If you want one answer only, you've got to make it clear which is the correct answer. Also, the fact that we have in D, only ever in Birmingham, that's an absolute. Things are rarely absolute. Now, what would you do if you had this in a quiz and students had answered? You'd have to go in and edit this question either to remove it from everyone's answers score or to give everyone the grade for it to make it correct. This is a faulty question here. Number 6 out of 7, I hope you're keeping your score just out of interest. Question number 6, which of these statements is not true? A, Black country is not spoken in London. Older people, B, older people in the region do not tend to use Black country terms. C, Black country is not a modern dialect. Or D, questions with double negatives are not easy to understand. I can't even remember the answer I put myself for this. Okay, so please type what you think.
Lucas says, I'm leaving that one blank.
Well, you might as well put an answer, Lucas, because you might guess and you might get it right. Mightn't you? That's what I used to say to my students all the time, just guess. We don't penalise you for guessing wrong. Okay, anyone like to, what's the general thoughts?
Well, people is confused now. I don't think we have a clear view, perhaps a little bit of A's around. I don't see C, but A, B, and D are part.
Okay, right.
Not the A, B, I would
say. The correct answer is B. Older people in the region do not tend to use Black country terms. That's not true. It does tend to be older people in the region who use Black country. It's less used now. And the other three are true. But the problem is, and I am a native English speaker, and I struggle with this, and I wrote the question. If you're going to put a question which is not true, and then your answers have negatives in them, it's really difficult to get your head around it. You have to take out the negatives and try and make it affirmative and then work it out, which is why Lucas gave up. So my advice here is to avoid negatives in your questions and responses and try to make affirmative statements. And also again with D, this is very true, but also it's irrelevant. This isn't anything to do with the Black country. So it removes a possible answer there. So our final question, one very dear to my heart, actually, question number 7. Following its assumed origins, if we assume its origins in PIE, whence BCD? Is it A, more than 80% AS, B, quite a lot of OE, C, NF, or D, trick question, its origins are not PIE? There may well be someone who knows this, because there's certainly someone, I imagine, surprisingly, who knows the Black country, I saw. So maybe someone does know this, but let's see.
Well, it's really fun because most of the answers in the chat are C's or question marks or a bit, I would say this, annoyed participants.
Oh, perfect.
Yeah, what's this?
Excellent. Right. Well, what can we learn from this question then? Well, we can learn the answer. The answer is A, as a matter of fact. But the problem is manifold. First of all, in the question, following its assumed origins in PIE, whence BCD? BCD, Black Country dialect. Who says whence? Whence is not used in standard English, so why use it in a quiz question just to make yourself sound clever? Use standard English, French, Russian, German, whatever your language is. Also, if you're going to use abbreviations, make sure your students know what they are. And I'm assuming you don't know, so I shouldn't have used them. You could use the full form and then afterwards use abbreviations, but how can you know that PIE stands for Proto-Indo-European, which is the supposed original language that many of our European languages come from, unless you learned it? AS stands for Anglo-Saxon. So 80% of the Black Country dialect is Anglo-Saxon English. OE stands for Old English. And look at this, quite a lot of Old English. Vague figures don't tend to be the right answers. If you're going to give answers, correct answers, they should be precise. Yeah, more than 80%. That's precise enough. NF is Norman French, by the way. And also D, trick question. Don't have trick questions. I know it's tempting, but you're trying not to trick the student, I hope. You're trying to find out what they know or help them to progress rather than catch them out. Okay. So it was pretty difficult to guess or to work out. So don't worry about that. I'm just interested, before we pause, would you like to tell me your scores? And let's see what the kind of approximate average was.
Okay, 5, 4, 5, 4, 3, 4, 4, 3. Well, it's like 0. Yep, that's also
okay. Well, do you know, I figured that if you paid very close attention, you should be able to get 4 out of 7. And if you got more than 4, you were either lucky or very, very, very clever. Yeah. Because the first 4, you should have been able to work out. But don't worry if you got less. My husband actually got 2, and he's a native English speaker. So, not, and he got the first one wrong, the Oss Road. So I'm just going to pause there. I'm apologizing in advance for this slide, which has lots of text, and I don't approve of slides with lots of text. But this is basically summarizing the lessons that we've learned from that quiz. And I've put this here so that if you get the presentation after the webinar, it will be available for download. Or if you're watching the recording, what we've learned and what I've explained as we've gone through these questions is there. For instance, making sure your grammar doesn't give away the answer. It might be a different kind of grammar in a different language, but it's still possible that you could accidentally give away the answer. Avoiding absolute statements, avoid ambiguous questions, trick questions, abbreviations, joke answers, and so on. Okay. I'm just going to pass it over to you for a few minutes, looking at the time. Do you have any more question traps? You see this picture, you remember the picture of the graphic of the Black Country. If I were to put that into a quiz question, a question with an image, and ask about it, would I need to think about a potential trap there? Okay, over to you, Anna, for some comments or thoughts from people.
Well, we have some comment already from Kim, says, always do a spell check on.
Yes.
Yes. John says, is there an option, optimal number of options to offer?
Yes. Well, we're going to look at some tips in a moment, and we'll look at the optimal number of options there. Okay.
Kathy says that then none of the above, all the above types are very bad practice, indeed. Richard says avoid using, yeah, none of the above.
I wish I thought of that. You know, they always forget something. None of the above, especially as I've discovered, if you use none of the above and then you accidentally shuffle the answers, none of the above could come in the middle or at the top. So, you know, it's best not to use it at all. Very good points. Okay.
I would also say the specific questions like A and B are correct, because again, with the shuffling, it's messy. And again, it's quite pointless. It's better to make it a multiple choice, multiple answers. Fairu says, how we can estimate necessary time to answer?
How we can estimate the necessary time? I think basically by trying it out. You can look at the statistics, the reports from the quiz and see how long people took to answer. But on the other hand, that doesn't necessarily tell you if they're just going through and guessing, you know. So that's a very good question.
I can tell my tip to Fairuz.
Yes, please.
Is that I'm usually calculating 1 minute to one question. The time is huge, but the pressure that timer applies over to the people who take the quiz is also huge. So you don't have to worry. It's just more like you creating the feeling of a rush, of you have to be prepared for that. Yes. So I wouldn't worry that much. And about the question you asked, Mary, regarding this picture, I would avoid to use the picture and use an option like black how this dialect was called and have a black inside, because so black the image.
Yeah,
obvious.
Yeah, don't say picture of black country or something. No, correct. Yeah. Okay, anything else or shall we?
Yes, we have more comments. Hugo says that the all the above and all none of the above, obviously, they validate partial knowledge. Stefan says that I don't like shuffling answers rather than short-term alphabetically.
Ah, now that's interesting. You've obviously been looking at my slides ahead of time, so we'll just keep on that one shortly. We'll look at that. Shuffling, to shuffle or not to shuffle? That is the question, yes.
Luca says, if not shuffling the answers, we tend to place the correct ones not on the top or the bottom. And when students are guessing, they won't choose the top or bottom option either. Kathy says that shouldn't really shuffle answers unless line length is the same. For readability, avoid the rigid layout.
Yes.
And Richard says that, what are your thoughts on negative marking?
Well, we could have a long conversation about that. In fact, negative marking comes in one of my tips here that you might want to consider or not. I don't have a problem with it myself, personally. I use it, for example, if you have multi-answer questions so that students cannot just think, I'll select everything because some of it must be right. So then you have to give negative marks in order to penalize them for simply selecting the wrong answers. But let's hold on that until we look at our question tips, actually. Are we okay to move on, Anna?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, building on what we looked at during our fun quiz, these are some things of what to consider. And I'm hoping that you have some other thoughts as well. Seven is the magic number today. So first of all, in terms of Moodle, when you're creating your quizzes, if appropriate, you could shuffle the answer choices. Now, as I say, if appropriate, this really does depend on your own circumstances and what your quiz is about. But something I found very useful since Moodle 3.11, if you are on a lower version, you'll look forward to this, is whatever you set in a question. So for instance, here we've decided one answer only, and we do want to shuffle the choices. Moodle will save that. So each time you make a new question, you don't have to select one answer only, shuffle the choices. It is saved for you. But as to whether you should shuffle the answer choices as well as the questions, and sometimes you don't even want to shuffle the questions, but to shuffle or not to shuffle, I would say, if it's important not to shuffle, try to list the options either logically or alphabetically. So in this question, which of the days of the week in English is named after the Viking god Thor? Well, of course, it makes perfect sense, whichever one is the correct answer, to put them in the order in which they come, from Monday to Friday here, for example. Alternatively, if theoretically, you could theoretically shuffle this one, but I think it might be better to make it alphabetically. Which of these words expresses a relation, time or place, to another word or element in the sentence? The answer is a preposition, actually. But in order not to give away any kind of clues, just put the answers alphabetically. There's no way of guessing. It's not in the middle, it's not at the top, it's not at the bottom, it's alphabetical. So those are some thoughts on shuffling. Now, in terms of what's the optimal number of responses, I was surprised. There's a research link on the slide here. There's also some more if you take the course afterwards. Obviously, you can have as many as you want, but apparently there's no benefit in having more than one correct answer and then two incorrect answers distractors. So you can, by all means, have more. So, for instance, you will know that the fun quiz on the Black Country, I decided to have four. I just happen to like four. I actually choose four because I think if you have three, you tend to pick the one in the middle sometimes. But there is no benefit. They've done experiments on three, four, five, and it doesn't make much difference beyond three, beyond one correct and then two incorrect. It's useful to know that simply because if you're one of those people who really struggle to think of answers or responses, you don't have to have a lot. Okay, this is close to my heart as well. Do make sure that if you're going to have a question which has one answer, which is 100%, it isn't a controversial topic, ambiguous topic. Which is the longest river in the world? There is some debate on this. How do you define longest, largest, deepest, tributaries, and so on? So do think carefully when you phrase your questions if it's one 100% answer. And of course, that leads on to what I will say shortly about having someone check them for you. And of course, this should go without saying, but I'm saying it for me, really. Sometimes when I'm creating a quiz, I think I have 10 questions. I've got two more to go. What can I make a question about? Always ensure that the questions match your learning outcomes. Keep them there in front of you as you create your questions so that there are no irrelevancies, so that you're not making question number 10 because you need 10 questions and you need to find something quickly. Okay. And going back to that, the ambiguous, controversial, always ensure that someone else, preferably a colleague, can proofread and check your quiz questions. Now, if you're sharing a course in Moodle 4 onwards, then in the question bank, there is the option, as you create a question, to set it as draft, which is basically saying, I'm not ready to use this yet. I want my colleague in the course to come and check it. And your colleague, and you see the other column in yellow here, comments, your colleague can look at it. They can comment on it. I think you need to rephrase this. It's a bit ambiguous. Then you can go back when you've had your feedback and you can select it as ready to use in your quiz. So in Moodle 4 onwards, this is a good way of collaborating on creating quality quiz questions. Now, for my final tip, I'd like to say, if you have done your best to create the best quality quiz questions, you've had them proofread and checked, yet you're still afraid that your students are just going to get lucky by guessing and get the answers right by guessing, what could you do? You might like to consider certainty-based marking. This does have issues with the grade book, I have to say, so perhaps the formative assessment really. But what certainty-based marking does is it means that if a student guesses correctly, or rather, let me explain, every time they answer, and you might like to answer this for me, by the way, every time they answer, you have to give your answer, and then you have to state also, you see where it says certainty, whether you're unsure, one, I'm just guessing, I don't really know, whether you're reasonably sure, two, or whether you are quite sure, three, because you learned the answer. And so then you will be graded according to, did you get it right because you were quite sure? You get extra points. Did you get it wrong, but you are quite sure? Then you lose a point. If you get it right and you guessed, well, you do get 1 point. You get the correct point for getting it right and guessing because, okay, it's right. It's correct. But if you get it right and you said, I'm sure because I learned the material, you get a benefit, you get a bonus. So you might like to consider this. And before we move on, would you like to try to answer it? And maybe you could tell me as well what your certainty is. Is this sentence correct? Thanks for inviting John and I to your party. Is it A? Well, it depends. It depends on the situation. We need more information. Is it B? That's correct. Yes, in good English grammar. Or is it C? No, it's not correct. So I'd like you to type A, B or C. That's your answer. But as well, put 1, 2 or 3. If you're guessing, if you think, yeah, I think I'm fairly sure. Or if you know the answer because you are a pedant. So would you like to tell us what people are saying?
Okay, some have used CC, I think it's C3.
Whoa.
But that's one case to underline. B's C3, C2, B2, yep.
C3. Okay, so we don't have any A, but we do have some B's and C's. The answer is actually C, it's incorrect. It should be, thanks for inviting John and me to your party. It's a common mistake called hypercorrection. But if you're interested in knowing more, you can look at the presentation afterwards. But the point is, if you guessed correctly, you get a point. If you got it correct, but you were very sure, you will get more because well done you. So it's something to think about, basically. Okay, so we had 7 tips from me, but I'd like to finish off in our last few minutes. Do you have any more tips? Do you have any comments or any questions just as we head towards the hour? Especially more tips, please.
Let's give some minutes so people can type in. Sonia provided a link, fun examples of bad questions, a link to, into a blog.
That's good. Feel free to there... in the forum, actually, the discussion forum afterwards in the course, if you like.
Yes, please. That would be useful. Are there any other new quiz questions features in Moodle 4? Chad is asking.
New quiz. Well, there are some new things in the in the question bank. Yeah, I'm actually, after this webinar, I am going back to updating the documentation and preparing presentations about what's new in Moodle 4.1. And there is some new question bank stuff. In fact, we are doing a webinar on the 15th of December for anyone who'd like to know what's new in 4.1, including the question bank. Yes.
Joe says that I always do the quiz as a student to test.
Yes.
Richard says, avoid inconsistent number of responses to questions. Yoga says, versioning. Fairuz says using random question is good for quality quizzes. I like that as well. Yes. Alex says there should be an opportunity for students to discuss the quiz after it is over. And Chris says that good to write the question set down separately before adding into the Moodle quiz. It allows you to organize your thoughts.
This is very good because I never do. I always do them straight into the quiz, but I know a lot of people who do write them separately. What do you do, Anna?
Well, I prefer writing them separately, and especially when it comes to multiple choice questions. I'm cheating a little bit because I can use the ICANN format and import all the document at once, or the VLE tools, if you are familiar with that. And I can get the quiz XML file and upload them all together. And because I'm not a native speaker, my English are always need for a review. So I prefer to have a document, get people review them, fix the language, have autocorrector while I'm writing questions, and then finally upload them. And one thing I love doing is what Fairuz said about using random questions. Mm-hmm. I prefer random questions, not only for the quality of the quiz, which is the main point, but also for the flexibility that it gives you.
Absolutely. And we do it in Academy, don't we? Yeah.
Exactly. And one tip, when I'm writing the questions directly into Moodle question bank, I always use meaningful names for the questions. For example, I never use 1, 2, 3.
Well, it
might. Because I never remember what was about it, and it will just takes me so long to search what I'm looking for. If I want to update something. We have inputs from people. Let's see what they do. Dave says, use the random question function with questions with slight changes. Fairu said that closed questions are good to multiple types in the same question. Yes. Kat says that I would say always write a storyboard, master answers document first. When build questions in Moodle, always preview each one to test that is all okay. In fact, in a company that I was working on, we had quiz made with random questions, and we want to review the quality of the question. I was doing like what Fairuz and Luca suggested. Kathy suggested. So I had a quiz for students to take it and a quiz for teachers and subject matter experts to review. And in the quiz of the subject matter experts, I was using all the questions, no shuffling, no anything. So just all the questions so they can quickly go through them and fix any troubles.
Okay.
Yes, Kathy says her recommendation to use a number with the title as well. Yes, that's also an option for sure. And I think that was all the inputs we have.
Well, please do, if you have any more comments, please come into the course afterwards and add your comments or questions in the general discussion forum. We'd like to get a discussion going there, and do the course, which should be opening up very shortly. I would like, as we finish, just to remind people, and if you're also watching the recording, how to get involved so we can grow Academy. We'd love you to go to our Get Involved course. It's linked to on the front page, and suggest topics which we could cover in future webinars and courses. This is an example of something which was suggested and which we then set up. Also, perhaps you would like to volunteer to present a webinar on Moodle Academy on your area of expertise. You could get a presenter's badge. And if you would like to help us, we'd love you to help us contribute to creating our courses. And again, you could have a course builder badge for that. So get in touch with us and help us to grow Academy. Also, it's not mentioned here, but we are, we'd be delighted if people could translate our courses as well. We have a Translate Moodle Academy course you could do and then start translating the various courses that we have. And if you enjoyed this webinar, please tell your friends and colleagues about this, about Moodle Academy. Come get a badge, tell others. If you're an educator and you haven't already explored the Moodle Educator Certification, please go and try our Are You Ready for the MEC course? And if you are, sign up with one of our certified service providers and take the MEC and be certified. It's a certification program for people who have experience and knowledge in using Moodle. And we'd be delighted for that. So I'm going to stop there now, and I'm just going to say thank you for joining. Thank you for all of your useful comments and contributions. Thank you from me, Mary Cooch.
Thank you. Nice to see you all here.
Thank you. Goodbye.